husband and wife, who the second they start bombarding my feed with pictures of the family, I know, okay, y'all are into some stuff right now. Somebody's in trouble. We've got to go out here. Let me reach out and make sure everybody's good. Y'all aren't getting divorced once again. That's the only one. Keep your kids off my social media feed, man. I don't want to see it. If it's not food and ridiculousness, I don't want to see it. Keep it away from me. What was the song?
Oh, one of my favorite songs of all time. Wilson Phillips' Hold On.
I'm coming.
Commonly known from the Bridesmaids movie that all the bridesmaids sing at the end. You familiar?
Oh, yeah.
I know that there's pain, but you hold on for one more day and you break free from the chains. I know that there's pain, but you hold on for one more day and you break from the chains. Someday somebody's gonna come around and make you wanna say goodbye.
Yeah, they will. Keep going.
Till then, baby.
Keep going until we get to the part that I want to know.
Don't you know? Things will change. Things will go your way.
If you hold on for one more day. Wait, for one more day or to yesterday?
One more day.
Oh, for one more day. Okay, cool. I guess you got to let yesterday go. That's the only reason I know that song. Is that movie.
That's where I first heard that song. And it became like the anthem of me and my high school friends, which led to us making a pact in high school that no matter where we went in life, no matter where our friendships were, we would all be bridesmaids in each other's weddings. And we have fulfilled that pact to this day. And I do not talk to them all of the time. And that we all live in different places. But you want to know who I texted this morning when that song came on? The Fab Five of Thunder Ridge High School. Go Grizzlies forever. Yeah, that's annoying. I know it. What's up, everybody? It's Wednesday, April 3rd. It is going to be a good day. Jessica Benson with you from the Grind City Media Studios in Memphis, Tennessee. Coming up on today's show, it's a Grizzlies game day. It was also a very busy night around the NBA last night. We will talk about Joel Embiid's big return, the Jokic-Wemby battle, and yes, I really did watch some of the NIT, because of course I did. Then we will do some Oops, We Missed It Again stories from the week we have not gotten to. Ryan Silverfield got a new contract at the University of Memphis. 12.3 million people watched the Iowa-LSU Elite Eight game around 40-50 minutes in. D'Angelo Williams will join us. We never know what we'll get into with him. And then we'll wrap up with a little story time and WTF Wednesday. If you are joining us live, be sure to vote on today's story time options in the chat question of the day. Your options are rehoming a kid's first dog, don't post my kids' pictures online, toy guns for kids, and too much cuddling, of which there is no such thing. We'll have some fun as we do every Wednesday. Let's go.
Johnson live Saturday, April 13th at FedEx Forum. Country's best. The Leather Tour with Cody Johnson. With special guest Justin Moore. Also featuring Drake Milligan. VIP and reserve seats on sale at Ticketmaster.com in the FedEx Forum box office. Cody Johnson.
Maxwell in concert. The Serenade Tour, October 16th at FedEx Forum. Maxwell, with special guest Jasmine Sullivan, and October London. Tickets on sale now at LiveNation.com. Don't miss Maxwell Live.
Did I invent this, Loki?
Did you?
I spent years calling my ex-producer Cowboy Carson, and now Beyonce,
she decides
she wants to dabble in country, in the genre. Now she's calling her album Cowboy Carter.
When she's doing her next concert, and she says, hey, my new album's about to come out, Cowboy Carter.
It's inspired by the Gary Parrish Show.
Shout out GP in Memphis.
The Gary Parrish Show, live weekdays at 10 a.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Gasol with 4 seconds for the win. Yes!
Mark is one of the more competitive people you'll meet.
Yeah, he loses.
That willingness to go out and try to compete every day, not just wait for a game, not wait for a regular season game, not wait for a playoff game, but every day is what made Mark special.
He was a big part of that identity, right? And a big part of that's why the team was so successful, because they had that anchor in him.
Grizzlies
to this day wouldn't be the Grizzlies without the contribution of Marc Gasol.
Don't worry, Be Fluffy World Tour.
The minute you get into a brand new relationship, like magic, you know who really notices just how happy you are, guys? Other women, not your woman. Look how happy he is. I bet I can change that.
Friday, May 10th, FedEx Forum. Get your tickets now at fluffyguy.com. Don't miss a Memphis. Don't worry, Be Fluffy World Tour.
Hey, Grizzlies fans, after exciting hoops and a lucky night of gaming, where do you rest your head? Look no further than Southland Casino Hotel, proud sponsor of the Memphis Grizzlies. Our high-rise hotel is the epitome of luxury and comfort. Picture this, you've just finished an evening of gaming and dining, so you head on over to one of our 300 rooms to end the night. Choose from standard, suite, and presidential suite, plus we're pet-friendly and offer mobility scooters for rent. It's a seamless experience for everyone. And don't miss the Main Street Exchange, right in the heart of our casino lobby. Whether you're craving a snack or need a souvenir of your stay, we've got you covered. From polo shirts to shot glasses, take a piece of the Southland excitement home with you. So come stay and play at Southland Casino Hotel, where every moment is designed for your enjoyment. Book your hotel stay by calling 833-703-3350 or visit online at southlandcasinohotel.com/hotel.
Guests must be 21 years of age or older to check in at hotel. Must be 21 plus. Play responsibly. For help quitting, call 800-522-4700.
Presents The Jessica Benson Show with CJ Hurt, live from the Grind City Media Studios on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Happy Wednesday, everybody. Happy hump day, middle of the week. Hope everyone is doing swell. Watched a ton of basketball last night. Lots to get into on today's show. But CJ, I have a very important marriage question for
you.
I
love when we get questions in the morning. First thing, let's go.
I've been waiting to tell you this story all morning, and it's killed me not to. But I wanted a genuine live reaction. Does your wife ever talk in her sleep?
She makes noises in her sleep. In fact, it's so bad that when we first started like interacting in that way, like slumber parties, she'd be like, hey, listen, I'm a moan, I'm a groan, I might say some things in my sleep. I'm just sleeping, that's how I sleep.
It's okay.
Like, oh, okay, all right. So she doesn't talk, but she'll moan and groan.
Okay, I would like to preface,
she's a banshee when she sleeps.
A banshee.
Now. Yeah, just making noises.
Great description, because I can immediately hear what
like,
that,
yeah. It's
unrestful.
Scooby-Doo villain.
Okay.
Like when the villain is chasing you and they make the noises. That's the noise she makes a lot.
Okay.
Yeah.
Chris will make noises like that. Like what happened last night, I will preface, is a rare occurrence. Okay. And the Warriors and Mavs played last night. I fell asleep to the sweet, sweet sound of Golden State Warriors basketball in a tight game against the Dallas Mavericks. And I kind of woke up towards the end. I realized Draymond had a game-sealing block. Warriors win. I don't have to worry about it. Sweet. Peaceful, sweet dreams. Night-night. Close my eyes. I'm in a deep, deep sleep. And in the middle of the night, all of a sudden, I am awakened by a scream of, "We gotta get out of here!" I pop up and I'm like, what's going on? Chris, are you okay? We gotta get out of here. I'm like, Chris, where do we gotta get out? Like, is our house on fire? Like, what's going on? At this point, I recognize he is but half awake, awake with his little eyes like this. I go, Chris, it's okay. It's okay. We don't have to get out of anywhere. You're good. He goes, we gotta get out of here. We've got to land the plane.
What?
I'm like, what? Plane. You are not a pilot.
Yeah.
And at this point, he kind of flutters back down and his head goes back down and he just goes, we gotta get out of here.
We've got to get out of here. And this, everybody, is a cautionary tale of what happens after you force your husband to watch the NIT. Because that's my only answer, is he was in such a distraught state after I made him watch Indiana State-Utah basketball earlier in the evening at Hinkle Fieldhouse. I kept calling it our Hoosiers event. But that man was screaming, we got to get out of here, in his sleep over and over again. I brought it up to him this morning. He has zero recollection. He said, no. I said, yes. And then he just went back to sleep. And I did too. So we can call it a funny story instead of me being freaked out that we need to get out of our house over and over.
He doesn't know what he was dreaming about?
No, he has no idea.
But
the possibilities are limitless.
He needed to get out of there. He had to land the plane.
So I'm thinking he was like flying. Pilot Chris.
Clearly, because he has to land the plane.
One would assume, unless he wasn't the one flying.
He's in the control tower.
The plane. He could be in the control tower. But perhaps he was in the cockpit and you're in a storm. And it's like, ooh, scary weather, and we have to land the plane. Or there's a mechanical issue. And, we, Boeing was in the news for so many weeks in a row, and now we've just stopped talking about it.
Weather's been in the news yesterday, those storms
were wild. And again, he was stuck in a living room watching Kareem Abdul-Jabbar have 26-10 last night for Indiana State. He just looked at me during that game. He goes, we're not doing this. I said, yes, we are. Look at this pass, CJ. Ooh. I audibly yelped at that pass as Indiana State blew this game open in the last 10 minutes and advanced to the championship game of the NIT.
Let's go.
But anyway, stand up. This is marriage, baby. One second you're watching the NIT. The next your husband's screaming for help landing the plane.
The worst thing that my wife does in bed is she'll cramp up.
Oh, no. The sleep cramps are the worst.
She'll scream bloody murder like a banshee and wake me up by slapping me like, rub it out. And it's always a calf. rub it out. She also,
mine's my foot. It is my foot cramps in my sleep.
Completely sleep. Then it is, rub it out. It's like, okay, why are you hitting me? I'm rubbing. Stop.
I'm trying my best.
I was asleep. You don't have to do me that way. Good grief. Drink a Gatorade. What do you want me to? I'm not your trainer.
Gatorade does not help with cramps.
What the hell are we supposed to do?
Well, maybe the electrolytes would help to some degree.
She's treating me like.
Hydration would probably be best.
I'm not a trainer for Clemson. We're not in Death Valley in
Grab the
heat.
Grab the Theragun.
What the hell do you expect me to do? What is going on here?
My worst thing in the middle of the night is when like you feel as if you're falling. You wake up to the feeling that you're falling and you're convinced that you just fell out of bed, but really it was whatever feeling was in your dream. And then you come to, anyway, I love Chris, but last night, I don't know what was going on in that.
Keep me abreast of this situation. This might be the start of a trend.
No, don't say that.
It might be.
No.
So neither one of you sleepwalk?
You want to know what's interesting? We had a very, and I promise we'll get to all the NBA action from last night. I don't know, maybe. We were having a conversation about like pivotal childhood dreams at dinner last night. Like, did you have a dream, a recurring dream from your childhood that you still remember to this day that had an overwhelming impact on you at the time?
Not recurring. Nightmares.
But one.
It's one. Okay. Nightmares happen. And my mom was like, hey, you got to pinch yourself. And if you something weird's happened, you know, you're dreaming. If it doesn't hurt when you pinch yourself, you're dreaming. And then you just take control of the dream. It's like, lady, you sound like a mad woman. You're insane. And one night, Freddy Krueger was chasing my little 7-year-old, 8-year-old body all over the place. And then my mom appeared to me in a cloud, like, pinch yourself, my child. And I went and I pinched myself, and my hand went straight through my forearm. I went here to pinch, it went straight through my forearm. I was like, oh, turn up, Freddy.
This is a dream.
And I just pulled out just two of them. Blow! Shot Freddy up. And then I went to a casino of all places
amazing.
After that. I'm 8.
It's like, I love the random location pop-ups.
I just killed Freddy Krueger. What am I going to do? I'm going to go to a casino. Why not? And
play
just
some
went
slots.
To a casino and play some slots. And then I woke up. It's like, uh-oh, now I can control my dreams. So nightmares are few and far between now.
I wish I would have had that conquering information. I had a recurring dream where in my house growing up, there was a witches convention, and this came around the time that I saw Wizard of Oz for the first time, and I became deathly afraid of fire as a kid. Like, I didn't like birthday candles. My mom couldn't light candles in our house for a period of time, and a part of it was because of this dream, and I would always lock myself into this armoire chest that my mom had in her bedroom, and the witches would then set our house on fire, and I'd be trapped in the armoire, and it was the witch from the Wicked Witch of the West from the Wizard of Oz, and she'd be doing that like cackle, like that, and that came over and over and over again, and it was so scary. And we had seen a live production of the Wizard of Oz, and they used real fire in it. And when you're a kid, you see pyrotechnics, and you're like, something must be wrong, like something's on fire, and you look around, and no one's having any sort of reaction, and you're like, the table's on fire! What's going on? Come on! So that one came up for me. Chris's was on the Chernobog from Fantasia, the Mickey Mouse thing, you know, like the evil demon sequence within that. Anyway, shout out Dreams. What a weird place that we exist. We ended yesterday's show talking about existentialism and who are we and what are we in this world, and we started today with all of the dreams. I did watch some of the NBA action from last night. The biggest story in the NBA was, of course, Joel Embiid's return. He played 29 minutes for the Sixers last night in their win over the Oklahoma City Thunder. Thunder were without Shai Gilgeous-Alexander, but Joel Embiid in those 29 minutes had 24 points, 6 rebounds, 7 assists, first game back since he had that procedure on his knee. He talked afterwards about how this injury in particular was really hard on him mentally. Like, he was straight up depressed when it came to this injury. In the past, he's gotten injured. It's okay. One day at a time, we get back. But if we remember how well Joel Embiid was playing, he was an offensive menace this season. I think we had a conversation on this show like 2 days before he got injured where, stupid me, said this is Joel Embiid's MVP season. Like, there's no way he doesn't win MVP at this rate. And then 2 games later, he goes down with the knee injury, misses significant time. He will not be MVP because of that time missed. But the Sixers are just so much better with him. And now they're fighting for their playoff positioning lives. They have a huge game against the Heat on Thursday. They're 2 games behind the Heat and the Pacers. You really don't want to be in that lower play-in tournament game because that winner has to play the Celtics, and the Celtics feel like such a juggernaut. You'd much rather play the Milwaukee Bucks, who cannot for the life of them win a game on the road. They lost to the Wizards last night. The Wizards, with no Kyle Kuzma. But are you excited about the, because that might not be the right word, inspired by the Sixers if they have Joel Embiid, that they could be one of these teams that makes a true run in the East?
Yes. Yeah. I am both excited and inspired. Okay. The Celtics will give you games and series, and hell, they'll give you a whole series. Now, it seems like the only team that they give the whole series to, the Miami Heat, regardless of what's going on, the Heat might have something figured out. But yo, if you're telling me Joel Embiid is out there, aging Al Horford is going to have to guard him, and I'm not, Al Horford has been aging for the past 5 years, so let me be clear. But it's another year older for Al Horford. You're telling me that Kristaps Porzingis is going to have to get out there and guard him in a series where everybody's healthy. That's the caveat for all of this.
Sure.
Everybody is healthy. Of the four, Tatum, Brown, Embiid, Maxwell, like, rank them. Because I would go Embiid, Tatum, Maxwell, Brown, which would then mean that I think Embiid, the duo of Embiid and Maxwell, is better than Tatum and Brown. Mm-hmm. And I do think that. And so now it is, all right, you've got two of the best players on the court on your team. What can you do? And this is all assuming that everybody's healthy. And in the playoffs, you do get a bit more rest than in between games than you do in the season. But yeah, I think that the 76ers versus the Celtics might want to watch out, even though they're having a spectacular season.
And I would absolutely take,
I said Maxwell. I got the Maxwell commercial in my head.
I know
Maxie,
you do.
Maxie.
Okay. Tyrese Maxwell, a.k.a. Tyrese
Maxie. He's got pretty wings.
He's so smooth, you know? That's how it works. No, I really like the Sixers if they match up against the Bucks. I know your dad is in the chat this morning, and so I will cautiously.
His head is going to explode because the three players he hates, he loves to hate on. And if I'm ranking them NBA style,
we all know number one.
Dang.
Duh.
Joel Embiid is number two.
Oh.
Joel Embiid is a close two. And then James Harden is,
how close are we talking?
Like 1A, 1B.
Ooh.
Like, he loves hating on Joel Embiid.
He's a little quieter in his hate for Embiid.
Because we are.
I looked at that Bucks loss to the Wizards last night, and I was like, oh, he's going to be out. And then I saw Damian Lillard didn't play in that game. And the Grizzlies, of course, play the Bucks tonight in Milwaukee. The Bucks so much better at home this season. On the road, the Bucks are 18-20 on the road. And when people are like, how does that happen? You can't help but think, maybe it's because they don't play defense. And defense is usually what travels in the NBA and gives you some legs to stand on. But the Bucks don't play defense anywhere. That has been such a significant struggle. I know Doc Rivers talked about it last night. Like, we're not taking the professionalism enough, whatever. Eventually, you're going to get to the playoffs, and you're going to have to try to win games on the road. If you're the two seed, you'll have home court advantage, at least through the conference final, or until you get to the conference finals, if things were to play out in the way where seeding goes chalk. But God, they are not good defensively.
Oh, but
117 points to a Wizards team with no Kyle Kuzma yesterday.
Yeah, no, that's not good.
Nope.
That's bad.
That's bad.
And you've been this all season. Now, they've been this, and they're second in the East. Right. And if they were in the West, they'd be a top four team. I do believe I looked on Monday. So they'd still be a top four team in the West. The issue is they're so far behind Boston in a wins-loss thing. Are they still 11 and a half, 12 games back or something like that? So I guess, okay, 12. If 12. Boston seems to be the creme de la creme in that conference and probably the team best suited to challenge Denver in the postseason. You have to get by them. Can you do that? I don't want to speak for anybody else. I can't get what happened against the Heat out of my head for the Bucks from last year. So even if they get the two seed with the defensive issues that you pointed out, with the issues on the road that you pointed out, add on to it how disappointing that performance was against the Heat. Was that a sweep? Was that a five-game thing? Sure, the Bucks were injured. It might have been five.
I thought it was in five.
It was five.
Yes.
Five games, one seed
and
going
Miami
out to the eight seed.
And Miami had that crazy rally in game five where they came back.
Not supposed to happen if you're the one seed, no matter how injured you are. If you got Giannis, you're not supposed to go out to an eight seed. I can't get that out of my mind, which then means for me, hey, no matter what, even if they have Giannis, Giannis is not the type of player who's just going to drag dudes all the way through a playoff. He couldn't do it against the Miami Heat. Mm-hmm. Now, that was a Miami Heat team that did get to the Eastern Conference Final, but still, get to a... they got the Eastern Conference, didn't they? Or did they go NBA Final? I can't remember. They got far in the playoffs is all I'm trying to say. So, add all those things together, I've got concerns about the Bucks also.
The game that I wish that I would have watched in real time last night but ended up ingesting it via highlights and reaction after was the Nuggets-Spurs game. The rest of the league has to figure out for the foreseeable future, if you want to win a championship, how are you going to A, get through Nikola Jokic, who won one last year, and B, get through Victor Wembanyama eventually, because those two going at it last night was tremendous basketball, and just the way that they battled back and forth and were laughing with each other. Like, Victor Wembanyama is out there blocking nine shots. He almost had a quadruple double. He had nine blocks in the game. But look at him and Jokic just having a little laugh. And this is what terrifies me more than the full court out of bounds baseball pass from Jokic, giving his best Steven Adams impression. But yes, he's all the way out of bounds. It's more impressive than Jokic going off for 42 points in the win, along with 16 rebounds and 6 assists. It's more impressive than Wemby's almost quadruple double stat line. It's that they're just having fun. It's like European game, respect European game. And they're just out there having a good little giggle. It's sick. It feels sick for everybody else.
Shh.
No, not the whisper.
Do you hear that?
We haven't whispered all week.
That's the sound of windows closing.
Shh.
Good Lord. We talk about big. We've talked about it with Mike in particular about, what type of big works in the NBA. And the type of big that you're going to need is a type of big that can do something with that.
Mm-hmm.
Eventually, at some point, if you are drafting a big, you've got to be drafting with, okay, we've got to be able to get a big who can guard Jokic and or Wemby and or contribute in some way against these two behemoths of men. Because Wembanyama walking around there with nine blocks is incredible.
Nine.
Jokic, what he's able to do, the way they facilitate the offense through Jokic for large spurts of the game is phenomenal. All right? And you could put those two in there, throw Sabonis in there, his old facilitating ass. You throw Jaren Jackson Jr. in there, his old dynamic offensive game plan having ass, and his old defensive player of the year having ass. Like, you throw all of these really dynamic bigs in, And it is, okay, we've got to have one of those, Jared Allen. Like, the I think that the era of just screen and roll finish at the rim bigs, I think that's they're going to be dinosaurs here in a moment. It's not, I'm not going to say it's all the way over yet. I will say, appreciate that while you have it. Appreciate bigs who are just Clint Capella in this thing, setting the screen, rolling to the rim, and catching lobs. Appreciate that while it's here, because this is a different era of big men, and I love it.
So I saw the perfect clip yesterday that fits with this current evolution of the game, and just a reminder of how the game today is in such a different spot than 30 years ago. And imagine 30 years from now, like, we're going to have actual aliens out on the court, because we already have some semblance of that when it comes to a Wemby and a Jokic. But there was this clip of Michael Jordan that went viral, and it was the play-by-play and analyst response to him going behind the back in a game for the first time. And they acted like it was, like, straight from the heavens came this play where, oh my God, Michael Jordan had the audacity to go. He invented a new play before our very eyes. And it was awesome. Like, I'm not taking away from what that was. Like, Michael Jordan, one of the greatest of all time. I'm so fed up with the GOAT and the legacy conversation. Can we not just appreciate greatness as it happens in front of our eyes and as things evolve and exist in different times and places? Apparently not. But you look at Michael Jordan then. You look at that baseball pass from Jokic last night from out of bounds. Like, imagine the broadcasters of then seeing a big man like Jokic do what he did in that game last night. See Victor Wembanyama block 9 shots. Your eyes would be like, they'd expand so wide they would pop out of their sockets. This block from Wembanyama, Reggie Jackson's face afterwards looks like he's been sent to the gulag. Like, he's like, what just happened to me? And he plays with Nikola Jokic. It's remarkable. It's very fun to watch.
Big man battles have changed, and they're still good. Like, Shaq versus Mourning was one of my favorite big man battles to watch, because those were just big, swole, athletic freaks just banging one another. Shaq and Ewing. Ewing in the morning, right? Like, those, I loved it. I loved it just to see them bang and battle with one another on the block. Well, now they're banging and battling all the way to the three-point line. And they're putting the ball on the floor. They're going by each other. They're blocking each other's shots. They're pulling
they're
up for jump
shots. They're going behind
the back. They're going behind the back. Like, it's incredible. And this was, I feel like this is the, when, you remember that All-Star game where the West put 4 7-footers on the court?
Yes.
And they went to Shaq, and Shaq wasn't on the court with the 4 7-footers. He's like, ah, I was trying to get on the court so I could run point form. It was Dirk, it was KG, Tim, and it was another one who was on the court. Shaq wasn't. But it was like, oh, okay. The game might be moving in a different way as it pertains to these bigs. I feel like what we saw last night was a culmination of that particular moment. Whereas, hey, you know what? Don't be so limited in what you think tall people can do. Make their asses dribble. Don't just let them sit down there and only do post work. Put them out there in the open court in practice and make them dribble so that they can do some dynamic things. And Wembanyama and Jokic are two of the better ones at doing it right now in the NBA.
All right, before we take a quick break, it is a Grizzlies game day. Grizzlies Bucks tonight in Milwaukee. Jaren Jackson Jr. not on the injury report, which is notable considering he hit that 65-game mark, which you need for postseason awards eligibility. Desmond Bane still out. Vince Williams Jr. still out. But as we do every Grizzlies game day, it is time for our Tankathon draft simulation. What was this season made for? It was made for this. If the Grizzlies were to draft today, hit the sim lottery button. We have got the Grizzlies picking 8th. God! Whatever. As of this morning, through the whim, I'm team trade the pick. You've got to build a front court that competes with Jokic and Victor Wembanyama, and I don't know if I participate. I can't even speak. They've got me speechless. Particularly like the idea of a rookie center having that much responsibility alongside Jaren Jackson Jr. in the Grizzlies front court. And yes, we continue to see Brandon Clark come back, which is lovely. Grizzlies Bucks tonight in Milwaukee. Then they will be back for 5 of their last 6 games are right here on the home court at FedEx Forum. On the other side, we'll talk about Ryan Silverfield getting an extension with the University of Memphis. He'll be the coach through 2028. Other Jacob really wants us to give a shout out to Memphis baseball. And then, of course, the numbers came out for the Iowa LSU game. They were astronomical, most watched game in women's college basketball history. We'll talk about it on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Grizzlies fans, turn your stadium excitement into betting action at Southland Casino Hotel. As a proud sponsor of the Memphis Grizzlies, Southland brings you more gaming action than ever before. Step onto our massive casino floor stretching more than 2.5 football fields. Slot enthusiasts can enjoy more than 2,300 machines from penny slots to high limits and play the hottest games like Aristocrat, Dollar Storm, Cloverlink, and Lightning Cash. Table game aficionados can feel the thrill of the felt with 50 live table games. From three-card to blackjack match, we're ready to deal you in. Plus, don't miss stadium gaming for an interactive digital experience. And for high rollers, our high limit room is calling your name. Go big on 6 high limit blackjack tables or spin one of our 54 high stakes slot machines. Throw in 8 delicious dining options and a 300 room high rise hotel, and there's plenty to keep you going. At Southland Casino Hotel, the gaming excitement never stops.
Must be 21 plus. Play responsibly. For help quitting, call 800-522-4700.
Let's face it. There's a lot of trash talk in basketball, but the great teams let their performance do the talking. Like Ford F-150 with Pro Power Onboard, a class-exclusive industry-first feature that turns your truck into a mobile generator and leaves the competition speechless. Ford F-150, official truck of the Grizzlies. Greatness starts here at your Mid-South Ford dealer. Class is full-size pickups under 8,500 pounds, GBWR.
Sauced by Will Smith is taking their championship taste to FedEx Forum. Come enjoy your favorite lineup of sauces on traditional and boneless wings the next time you see the Memphis Grizzlies play. All of your favorite sauces, including the famous Garrick sauce, are now available as you cheer the home team on. Visit Sauced by Will Smith inside FedEx Forum at your next Grizzlies game, or come visit us anytime at our location in South Haven, Mississippi. Championship sauce, championship taste. Come get sauced today.
Now for a limited time, the new $1.99 crispy tender wraps are here at Sonic. Who could deny a crispy chicken tender with bold flavors like hickory barbecue and cheesy Baja? And we can't forget the crisp lettuce and melty cheese to make the perfect bite. Wrap yourself up with some TLC, tender, love, and chicken for only $1.99. Sonic $1.99 crispy tender wraps. Tax not included, limited time only at participating Sonic drive-ins.
Are you a healthcare professional looking for a new experience? Look no further than Travel Nurses, Inc. Our extensive network of healthcare facilities across the country offers you the opportunity to discover new destinations while pursuing your passion. We provide competitive compensation, flexible contracts, and dedicated assistance. So join our community of nurses and allied health professionals and start your next adventure today. Visit our website at travelnursesinc.com for more information.
Did you do anything in that St. Joe's game?
No, I was strictly playing defense. Delonte West was tough. That's a pro. Oh, my God. That step back.
Oh, wait. Hold on. 40 minutes. You didn't even get a rest.
No, I played the whole game. 40.
6 for 11 from the field.
That was me.
12 points, 6 rebounds, 5 assists.
Oh, I was nice that game. I thought I ain't getting double figures.
The Chris Vernon Show, presented by Caesars Sportsbook. Live weekdays at noon on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Did I invent this, Loki?
Did you?
I spent years calling my ex-producer Cowboy Carson, and now Beyonce.
She decides
she wants to dabble in country, in the genre. Now she's calling her album Cowboy Carter.
When she's doing her next concert, she says, "Hey, my new album's about to come out. Cowboy Carter.
Inspired by the Gary Parrish Show.
Shout out GP in Memphis.
The Gary Parrish Show, live weekdays at 10 a.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Doom.
Oh, yeah.
Welcome back to this Wednesday where we use all caps all day in the chat. If you haven't subscribed to Grind City Media on YouTube, if you haven't, what are you doing? Go ahead, hit today's like button to help us shoot to the algorithm moon. It is Wednesday. That means, oops, we missed it again. Stories from the week we have not yet gotten to. One of those broke yesterday after the show where we learned that the University of Memphis and head coach Ryan Silverfield struck a deal to keep him at Memphis through 2028. A new contract for Ryan Silverfield here in Memphis, coming off of last season's 10-win season. Ryan Silverfield, in his
4 years as head coach here at the University of Memphis, a 31-18 record overall. He has not won an AAC title. However, the AAC is a much diminished conference at this point, and the Tigers will be expected to be one of the best teams in the conference this next year. They should be expected to be one of the best teams going forward. Silverfield will make, according to the Daily Memphian, $2.2 million in 2024, $2.5 million in 2025, $2.5 in 2026, $2.6 in 2027, and $2.7 in 2028. That's $12.25 overall. That is a lot of money. And I like this move for the University of Memphis because in a landscape of so much instability around college sports in general right now, I do think there is value in establishing who your coach is, who you plan to have your coach be for the next couple of years. It helps in recruiting. It helps in NIL. It helps in establishing a more fortified culture here in Memphis. And he did just have a 10-win season. And I know there will be voices who think that he is not the person to get over that hump and to lead the Tigers back into the glory days of the Cotton Bowl season and everything that came with it. But listen, I think that Ryan Silverfield has done a good job. And I think maybe perhaps the most important thing with him is he wants to be here. Like, he has expressed over and over, he wants to be the head coach at the University of Memphis. I was in the press conference room when he was announced as the new head coach, when the interim tag was removed following that Cotton Bowl run, following Mike Norvell's departure to Florida State. And he was somebody who said all the right things. And you know, of course, that's what happens when you just got your head coaching job and when you're given an opportunity with a program that you've been a part of previously as the offensive line coach. He really loves this place. And I think that's cool right now. So shout out Ryan Silverfield and Memphis for making a move that puts them in a position where they know where they're at going forward. They right now have the third ranked overall recruiting class between recruits and transfers going into next season. He's shown that he can hit the transfer portal.
Wait.
Yes.
Third ranked overall in the American?
In the AAC.
Okay. There we go.
Yeah, no. Please. Like, well, we should have given him like $24 million.
How did I miss that story?
But he has gotten some, you know, P5 transfers from Indiana, from Ole Miss, from South Carolina, from Auburn. And, like, that's the name of the game right now. And we'll see going forward.
I think Tigers fans, there's a section of the fan base that's frustrated. And I can understand that because you brought up the diminished nature of American athletic football. And right now, and if Memphis was winning championships in the conference before the better teams left, why now that the better teams are gone, has Memphis sort of taken a step back? Some of that might be just the nature of this thing, although some of the good coaches, they have sustained high levels of success. What does high levels of success look like? If you're Memphis and you're not winning the American, or if you're Memphis and you're not playing in the conference championship, is there another way of measuring success? And for me, anybody who wins 10 games, that's a successful season. You win 10 games and then you win your bowl game, that's a successful season. They did that last year. Now there's another step. You can't only do that all of the time. You can't just go year after year of not competing for a conference title and be like, okay, everybody's going to ride with this. But you sprinkle in some conference championship appearances, you sprinkle in some actual conference championships, I think this fan base will take a step back, look around, and say, oh, we're a good football program right now. And they'll be satisfied with it. And stability, I don't know if stability breeds success or if it's the success that breeds the stability. But having one guy at the helm usually means that guy is good and good things are happening. I think the Tigers did the right thing by offering him the extension as well.
Yeah, and as Anthony Hall in the chat said, like he said, this isn't a stepping stone for him. And listen, coaches can say a lot of things. We talk about it often where coaches walk back on statements that they make a week ago. But for now,
Deion Sanders was going to save all of Black America at Jackson State. And Colorado, 1-11 Colorado came a knock. And he's like, yeah, I'm out. No, look.
Maybe. Saw those beautiful mountains, the Rocky Mountains.
I won't tell you what to do. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't believe any coach when they say this is not a stepping stone job for me. Even if it was a coach at Texas. You're telling me you're coaching at Texas, and then you look up, and I don't believe it. No, who's got a lot of money?
What's that song? Do you know that song? It's like, I'm not a stepping stone.
No, I've
like
never heard
that.
It's
a really old song.
I've never heard that.
But I don't even know who sings that.
You're coaching at Texas. Georgia comes and says, hey, we got $20 million for you. You're leaving freaking Texas to go to Georgia.
Yes.
Right? Like, that's just what what's going to happen. So I don't believe any of these dudes who, when they say they got their dream job or that this isn't a stepping stone. But again, Memphis did the right thing extending Silverfield. Let's see what they do this season on the field.
All right. Everybody and their mother watched the Iowa-LSU game, which was to be expected. But the number that came out from how many people actually viewed still blew people away yesterday. It was the most watched women's college basketball game of all time with over 12.3 million viewers. The championship game last year had 9.9 million viewers. This is a testament to putting games on places where people can watch. This game was on ESPN. The championship game was on ABC. But for reference, LSU Iowa, with the nice slow zoom out there, it beat every NBA game last season except for game five of the finals. It beat every college football game last season outside of the college football playoff, Ohio State, Michigan, and the SEC championship game. And it beat every single MLB game last season. People are watching women's college basketball. People are watching women's basketball. Period. This was an Elite Eight game. This wasn't even a Final Four game. And yes, everything that went into this game, as we have discussed ad nauseum, played a role in people being so genuinely amped to watch Caitlin Clark and Angel Reese and Iowa and LSU go back and forth on Monday night. But I know we're not supposed to care about them, CJ. If one more person tries to say, well, actually, it's because nothing was on Monday night. Shut up. You just don't know what you're talking about. The energy around the sport is awesome. I loved this tweet from LaChina Robinson yesterday, and to be honest, it made me a little teary-eyed, and I saw a lot of my fellow women having similar reactions to her words. But she said, for every former women's basketball player that had to play in an empty gym, and you went to college before the digital era, so you might get one TV game, and your mom wrote into the newspaper every time they didn't print the women's scores, 12.3 million is for you. You mattered then, and you still do. And this hit in a very specific place. And if you're a woman, you know, who at one point played in a game that felt like nobody cared and nobody was watching. And look at that, 12.3 million people cared about this game. And all the people who don't care still care enough to get into arguments that they could beat Caitlin Clark in a one-on-one game. I don't know what it is, CJ. It's like a moth to the flame. It's like a moth. My mention
why
yesterday.
Why are we doing that? They're in the DMs with it?
Yes, please make them stop.
Why are y'all sliding in DMs talking about being able to beat Caitlin? You're not sliding in the Caitlin Clark's DMs. Why are they talking to you about beating Caitlin Clark?
Because I have the audacity to say that Caitlin Clark is one of the greatest basketball players that we've watched. One of a collection. She is the all-time leading scorer in college. My favorite, just quick ranks, then we'll get to D'Angelo Williams.
Okay.
My favorite thing to do right now is to actually engage in some of these arguments because I always know they're going to go to the same place when I say she's the all-time leading scorer in college basketball. And without fail, the answer is, well, what do you expect? She had 5 years when everybody else had 4 years. No, she didn't. Argument over. You don't know what you're talking about. You're not qualified for this debate. So we're going to end it right there. On TikTok, on Instagram, on Twitter. I saw it happening to other people. Shout out to the people who cover women's basketball full time because, man, that stuff drags on you. And I cannot imagine the comments and the DMs that people who cover the women's game primarily and solely have to face always. I know you just like water buffalo it, let it roll off your back, don't really think about it, and you probably become numb to a certain degree. But alas. That's all. Sorry, that got me really
hot. Hoopers appreciate, that's the thing that bothers me. Right, like hoopers like hoopers. Hoopers appreciate hoopers no matter what race, gender, color, or creed you are. If you can hoop, hoopers look around and say, okay, he or she can hoop. I rock with that. And it's a lot of dudes out here who didn't play basketball past the seventh or the eighth grade for whatever reason and who aren't hoopers who have these types of takes. It's like, come on, man. Come on, that's that. You've got to have better things to do. If you don't like women's college basketball, if you don't like the WNBA, fine. But why are you constantly trying to shit on it when people are saying, hey, there's some good stuff over here. There's some stuff that might interest you. We do this all the time. I don't like the MLS a whole lot. I don't like MLB. They've been playing. We've got to get that inning counter graphic up because I still haven't watched But I don't come in when somebody's telling me how great it is that Shohei Ohtani has done this thing, or Ronald Acuna Jr. or whomever it is has done this incredible thing. This Aaron Judge has done this.
I think it's cool.
I don't come in like, yeah, hit a ball. That doesn't matter. Yeah, he's not that great. Have you seen the athletes over in the NFL? Those are the real athletes. No, I don't do any of that. It's like, okay, cool. Rock with it. Y'all got it? Live and let live, man.
Final Four weekend next weekend is going to be incredible on the women's side and the men's side. I cannot wait to watch. We'll take a quick break. When we come back, D'Angelo Williams will join us. Who knows what we will talk about with him? We will find out after a quick break.
Something you'll never do. I turn around and I level. You know motivation is needed. Look, I put myself on the pedestal. This is incredible.
Take your fandom to the next level with the official Grizzlies app. Go all access and behind the scenes.
It's got to be heavy defense. That's where it starts for us.
Personalized to where you are and who you are. Get easy access to ticketing, the game day guide, and your own app customization right at your fingertips. Upgrade your experience and download the Grizzlies app today.
Let's face it. There's a lot of trash talk in basketball, but the great teams let their performance do the talking. Like Ford F-150 with Pro Power Onboard, a class-exclusive industry-first feature that turns your truck into a mobile generator and leaves the competition speechless. Ford F-150, official truck of the Grizzlies. Greatness starts here at your Mid-South Ford dealer. Class is full-size pickups under 8,500 pounds, GBWR.
LifeCare Ambulance is proud to be an official partner of the Memphis Grizzlies and FedEx Forum. At LifeCare, they wear their hearts with pride. Their passion is their people. They want you to love what you do and where you do it. Their employee-driven culture encourages a healthy work-life balance and supportive work environment. They invest in your success and well-being so that you can provide the best care for the patients that they serve. Join the incredible team of EMTs and paramedics in Memphis, Nashville, and across the nation today. Learn more at lifecareamb.com.
It's more fun to be there live to see the Memphis Grizzlies hit the court all season long. From the electricity in FedEx Forum to the highlight reel plays, there's nothing quite like Grizzlies basketball. As the official marketplace of the Memphis Grizzlies, Ticketmaster gets you in with a huge selection of seats. So get off the couch and into the stands while you still can. Score tickets today at Ticketmaster.com. That's Ticketmaster.com.
Vince Williams is going to go to All-Star Weekend. Now, what a great thing for him.
Kudos to Vince Williams Jr. You know, he was an injury replacement on the Panini Rising Stars. He'll get a chance to be part of the All-Star Weekend Showcase.
Hey, Grizzlies fans, be sure to tune in to Grizzbeat, where the panel and I break down all things Grizzlies and take a look at the rest of the NBA as well. The show is live every Wednesday, 2 p.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Students, get back to the grind and cheer on your Memphis Grizzlies at FedEx Forum. Don't miss out on our exclusive student ticket program presented by Big River Steel. Get affordable tickets for all the major showdowns, including matchups against the Lakers, 76ers, Nuggets, and more. Sign up today to get alerts about this exclusive ticket deal at grizzlies.com/students.
We rushed for absolutely nothing because we are a bunch of dummies. Remember what D'Angelo said to us last week?
Not until you told me.
Remember when we said, see you next week, D'Angelo? And he said, no, you won't. I'm going to be in Disneyland Paris.
Not until you told me.
Yeah, so no D'Angelo Williams this week as he is bonjour, au revoir, oui, oui.
Show me. Do we want to do the rest of the stories in Oops? Do we want to do story time and then break and then do WTF? What are we doing here? How are we going to do this?
We only have one other story in Oops.
What is it?
Oh, I guess we do have two.
Yeah. What are the two?
The Angel Reese post-game comments that we didn't get into yesterday that everybody else had a wonderful opinion on.
What was the other one?
And DJ Burns' NFL chances.
Oh, yeah. Let's finish Oops. We missed it. We can knock that out in 13.
Okay.
Let's go. And if we knock it out in 10, we'll take a break and we'll do comeback.
Number one.
Let's go.
Yesterday, we spent so much time talking about the game itself that we did not get into some of the post-game comments that were made by Angel Reese and her teammates who came to her defense, which I thought was really cool, hearing from Vlaje Johnson, hearing from Haley Van Lith. Like, you don't know what Angel's all about. You're not with her every day. We are speaking to who she is as a person. Angel Reese kind of laid into the emotional side of it, talking about everything that she has gone through. As a refresher, in case you have not heard Angel Reese's comments, here is what she had to say.
I just try to stand strong. Like, I've been through so much. I've seen so much. I've been attacked so many times. Death threats. I've been sexualized. I've been threatened. I've been so many things, and I've stood strong every single time. And I just try to stand strong for my teammates because I don't want them to see me down and, like, not be there for them. So I just want them to always just know, like, I'm still a human. Like, all this has happened since I won the national championship, and I said the other day I haven't had peace since then. And it sucks, but I still wouldn't change. I wouldn't change anything, and I would still sit here and say, like, I'm unapologetically me. I'm going to always leave that mark and be who I am and stand on that. And hopefully the little girls that look up to me, and hopefully I give them some type of inspiration that, no, hopefully it's not this hard and all the things that come at you, but keep being who you are. Keep waking up every day. Keep being motivated, staying who you are, staying 10 toes, don't back down, and just be confident.
So I only have one true response to that. And that is, like, a great level of empathy and love for Angel Reese. And I think it is so weird how this became, on, like, a lot of national shows, it was a conversation on, like, does Angel Reese deserve to have this moment when she herself has leaned into the villain role? And, like, I just think that's the wrong conversation to have. I think if you can see a young person, a person, period, who is crying, who is emotional, who has received death threats, who has been over-sexualized, and I don't know if anyone forgot about Angel Reese being a part of the weirdo AI pictures that were going around, where the artificial intelligence photos of, like, women in swimsuits and women in, like, overly sexualized positions became a thing on Twitter there for a minute. She had those. It's weird. It's disgusting. But how you can watch someone who's hurting and have any response other than, oh, I feel for them. Sports does this weird thing to us where it's like, oh, she's the villain, so she's not supposed to. Like, no, she's a person. I don't know. Maybe that makes me weird, but that was my take. I was like, damn.
How dare you offer some sort of insight into the humanity of that woman who's the most hated women's basketball player in the game right now? No, you're right. I saw it, and I immediately thought, oh, this is what old girl was talking about in Barbie. What's her name? This is what she was talking about in Barbie, right? Sure. Here. That moment right there reminded me of the speech in Barbie, and it's, I don't think she's hurting. I think she's frustrated because her team just lost. And yeah. So you're super sensitive, you're super raw in that moment. That's your last, probably, college basketball game forever. Yeah, of course you are. That's the best part about the tournament. I saw it. Not only did I think Barbie, I was like, oh, this is great. This is why I watched the tournament for these types of reactions from these people. Because walking off of the court when your career is over for a lot of them, because they're going to go pro, professional, and something else, right? And getting those types of reactions, I think it's great. I find it odd that this is where we try and take the narrative. Mm-hmm. And that's just the way it is right now. When you've got shows whose whole thing is, I'm going to sit down and yell, you're going to sit down and yell, let's go. That's what happens. And that's bad for sports and bad for the storytelling component of sports as well. This woman went out there on a bum ankle and dropped nearly 20-20-5. On a bum ankle, giving it all for her team against a megastar. Mm-hmm. And that's where we go with the narrative. Yeah. And no matter what the hell she did, no matter what the hell she did on the basketball court or how she may have offended your sensibilities in whatever way she did it, she does not deserve to have death threats or rape threats or to be overly sexualized like you're saying. She is a person. They are people. Why do we have to have these conversations with folks once, twice a month about, hey, athletes are bleeping people, right. Y'all. Stop with all of this. No matter what she did on the court, she does not deserve, and it is not warranted to receive those types of reactions from folks. And I would think that we could all rally around that, but we choose not to because she's the villain. She's a villain, so hey, offer to kill her. Offer to rape her. She deserves it. She can't complain about that.
And I'll even take it like one step further. It's not even just the villain thing. We do this very weird thing where we police tears. Like, some people are allowed to cry and show emotion, and it's like, oh, look at that. A rare crack in the armor of this super athlete who's doing these incredible things. Like, I even, this past weekend, Juju Watkins was distraught after USC lost to UConn. She couldn't get through one of the questions in the press conference, and it was so emotional to watch because she has been such a strong figure in the sport, and I thought it was really, really cool that she cried, and at least my eyes, and granted I see through a USC lens, and so a lot of the things I see online are through a USC lens, but people were supporting her. I'll take it another USC, Caleb Williams, the quarterback. He cried during a game last year where he, like, went to his mom. Do you remember that game? And, like, they put up the piece of paper to hide him crying. And everyone was like, do you really want somebody who cries being your franchise quarterback next year? And that is the weird, like, why do we do this? So I'm not even making it a gendered thing. Like, this is a women's basketball player example with Angel Reese. But, like, if people want to cry, crying is good. Crying is healthy. Crying means that you have a general sense of ability to be in touch with your emotions. So, like, yeah.
Yes, and it's...
And I know men are weirder about crying than
who
women.
Who can cry and who can't? You spot on. But now listen, just because she said that, just because she did that, doesn't mean that I'm a liker. I still dislike her. I still sports hate her, right?
Like sports hate, yes.
Joel Embiid falling to the Raptors. Remember, he collapsed into Mark Gasol's arms because he was so overcome with emotion. Joel Embiid is sobbing uncontrollably after losing that series to the Raptors. Joel behaves sort of like a brick, so I crack some jokes, and I think that we can all crack jokes without it becoming homophobic, sexist, demeaning, right? If you're going to be a troll, when you fail, people are going to make fun of you.
Learn now, there's how to an be funnier.
There's an appropriate...
people...
Rape jokes and death threats aren't funny.
No.
They aren't. Like, you're not good enough a comedian to make those types of jokes funny. So stop making those jokes. You want to talk about how she got cooked by Caitlin Clark on the Switch?
Go for it.
Knock yourself out.
The shrug, both the Haley Van Lith shrug and the Angel Reese shrug.
Put them side by side. Knock yourself out. Crack all the jokes you want. But come on, we can't be threatening people like that. That's unacceptable.
I've seen multiple people in the chat say that I should help get Bronny James to Memphis. Unfortunately, I don't have that poll. And I'm also very confused about the Bronny James story thus far. I didn't even send it for our rundown, but I'll mention it. So this guy yesterday, Dick Weiss, who's the National Sports Writer Hall of Fame writer, award-winning columnist for the New York Daily News, he tweets yesterday that I wanted to read the specific tweet if I'm going to get into it. He says he can confirm the Bronny James story. Still think it's an idea whose time has come. Makes sense if it happens. I love the kid. Think he could be a star somewhere. And this was after somebody insinuated that Bronny James was transferring from USC. There's been no confirmation from Bronny James. I got last night myself because there is a Bronny James Twitter account with a blue check. And my God, I will never forgive Elon Musk for making a complete mess of the blue check situation. And not because blue checks mattered, but just because it made it easier for very public people to understand this is Bronny James. This isn't a Bronny James fan account, which I saw yesterday posting pictures of him in Duke jerseys and Ohio State jerseys and West Virginia jerseys. And I was like, oh, has Bronny James narrowed down his search of where he's considered transferring? No, because it wasn't Bronny James. And LeBron talked on it after the Lakers game last night too, and he said that Bronny has some big decisions to make. He was very non-committal on if Bronny had officially decided to transfer yet. There's been no official wording of it. If Bronny James wants to come to Memphis, I mean, Memphis just needs bodies. It seems like they need players. But Bronny James was a fine role player for USC this year. He needs more time. He's not going to go into the league next year.
A fine role player for a bad team.
But he's a freshman.
Yeah. Okay.
Freshman basketball player.
Yeah.
There's a lot of regular-ass freshman basketball players out there who are way worse than Bronny James.
Yes.
And there are some who are significantly better than Bronny James.
Yep.
That's the game.
And we don't talk about any of them.
I know.
We're only talking about Bronny.
Now, I do think my only interest piece of it is... You saw that LeBron has gone back into the pre-retirement speeches. He's like, I don't know how much time I have left. I just don't know. I'm not trying to make fun of him. But I am. Hey, because we're going to get so much of this until he officially announces that he's going to be on his last season tour. And you don't worry, we'll get an announcement.
We get a tour? You think we get a LeBron tour?
Please. Every single person who walks into a building is going to have the opportunity to say, this is the last time I'm going to get to watch LeBron James in my lifetime. Like, yes, that whole thing, all the pomp and circumstances around it will be excessive. But I did think it was interesting how quickly these kind of conversations, and he's been on a tear. Like, what he continues to do is remarkable work. But I think the understanding that he's not going to play in the league with Bronny James has certainly shaded what direction he might end up going and when. It might put a different time stamp on his future in the NBA if there's not that opportunity, which it looks like there will not be. So we get through that. What was our other Oops, We Missed It Again story that we hadn't gotten to?
Is RJ going to the NFL?
It's DJ.
Is DJ going to the NFL?
You can't call him RJ.
My fault. You
DJ,
got in my
are you
head.
Sure that you don't want to change your initial
DJ, my bad, D. Is D going to the NFL? Is Burns going to the NFL?
He says he's open to NFL interest, but says NBA is the plan. So your future, Kenneth Lofton Jr., is coming in to the NBA more than likely. This all came after there was a report this week that DJ Burns had captivated NFL scouts with his size and his agility and the thought that perhaps he could have some future as an offensive lineman somewhere in the National Football League. It's not like completely out of the question. Like, there are former college basketball players who pursued NFL careers. Tony Gonzalez, Antonio Gates, Jimmy Graham, Julius Peppers, Donovan McNabb, Connor Barwin.
I don't know what position he played.
I don't either. Terrell Owens, Julius Thomas.
Okay, Terrell doesn't count. That was low-level division.
Vincent Jackson.
Was Donovan on Syracuse's men's basketball team?
According to this article, he was.
Okay, all right. Was Debo on? Debo wasn't on the basketball team, was he?
Was he?
Jacob said there was a basketball and football player for South Carolina. Mm. Debo was Clemson, though. So that didn't work anyway. But either way it goes, this would be fun. Most of the time this. My point was, most of the time we see basketball players convert to football players after playing their entire career as basketball players. It is on the tight ends do that. Mm-hmm. I can't think of an offensive lineman to do it. I couldn't think of any lineman. Jabril Peppers aside, because Jabril played both. Jabril was elite at both. What a freak athlete he was. He was elite at both basketball and football. Charlie Ward is another one that I didn't hear you say, but he comes to mind. Heisman Trophy winning quarterback. Yeah. Played basketball for Florida State. But he doesn't count either because he played both. If you're playing
that's the difference. Sure.
So when you usually only play one, usually you are of a size and athleticism to go out there and play tight end in the NFL. I can't think of offensive linemen who could do that. I look forward to seeing if the homie DJ can. Have you seen the Draymond Green highlights of him playing spring football for Michigan State? Because he tried it. He tried it.
Not good?
No. He easily made the right choice. If Draymond had to go the G League route, he would have made the right choice. He was not good. He was running around like Tebow out there.
Imagine a world where Draymond Green played football instead of basketball. Oh, what a world this would be. All right, please find them. We're going to take a quick break. It's Wednesday, which means we have some story times. I might call an audible. We might get two story times today since D'Angelo Williams wasn't here. Thus far in the chat question of the day vote, too much cuddling has 31% of the vote. Don't post my kid's picture online has 28% of the vote. I have big feelings about people posting way too many pictures of their children online, and I can say that as a non-parent at this point in my life myself. But we might get into both of those. Get your votes in. See if you can sway it a little bit before we come back on the other side.
Grizzlies fans know it's the team that gives you the edge. Big River Steel does too.
That's why we're recruiting the best talent to help us develop the sustainable steel needed for today and tomorrow. Join us at the edge of the future. Visit www.bigriversteel.com/join to join our Dash team. That's www.bigriversteel.com/join to join our Dash team.
We know there's only one team you want to watch, and Bally Sports is the place to get your Grizzlies. Experience the comebacks, the buzzer beaters, the can't-miss Memphis-made moments live. Bally Sports keeps the grind going before and after the game, too, with Pete, Brevin, Fish, and Chris on Grizzlies Live. Watch Grizzlies basketball all season long with Bally Sports and streaming on the Bally Sports app. Bally Sports, home of the only team you want to watch.
When it's all on the line, you turn to the strong, the stable, the unwavering, to those with a history of raising their performance to meet the moment. It's true in basketball. It's true in banking. Grizzlies checking from Pinnacle. Play hard, bank easy. Open a Grizzlies checking account with at least $100 and a recurring direct deposit by April 30th, and you could receive a $200 direct deposit bonus into your account. Details at grizzliesbanking.com. Member FDIC.
There was some sad news coming out of the WWE. Michael Jones, also known as Virgil, passed away. He's a Virginia Union alum, so he graduated from an HBCU. He got his start in Memphis, right?
Oh, man, you're absolutely right. He started in Memphis in 1985.
Get all of your HBCU sports and culture news by tuning in to HBCU Huddle with CJ Hurt and Mike Wallace. New episodes drop every Thursday on GrindCityMedia.com, YouTube, and Spotify.
Let's talk about some of the guys who get dunked on the most.
Mel Turpin. There's a great clip on YouTube, kids. Go look this up, where Michael Jordan gets the ball in the post, spins around John Stockton and dunks. As he runs down the court, a fan in Utah says, "Hey, pick on someone your own size." The next time down, Michael Jordan comes down. 7-foot-tall Mel Turpin's under the basket, and Jordan just hammers on him. And as he runs down the court, he turns to the fan and says, "Was he big enough?"
IMHO with Lang Whitaker and me, Kelsey Wright Johnson, on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
I think we have the college basketball title futures. UConn's number one.
I really like Houston. I'd have them winning it all, but you can't be giving Drake jerseys. What is wrong with you?
Maybe the Drake curse is stronger in college basketball.
Well, how long has he been riding with Kentucky?
He wore an Alabama jersey and Saban retired.
The Odds Couple with Rob Fisher, Lang Whitaker, John Roser, and CJ Hurt live Thursdays at 2 p.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
This is another JBS production.
Twinkle, twinkle, rockabye. It's story time. Let's let it fly. The JB Show with CJ here to bring you tales that bring you cheer or fear or tears, whatever's here. Now hush you babies, listen up. It's story time. Let's get turned up.
I saw that. All right, before we get into story time, one, shout out Other Jacob, our fearless director, who CJ and I bombard with content during every commercial
break.
Shout out
to Other Jacob for doing his job.
For doing his job, yes.
For doing his job.
I think more people should be given flowers for just doing the damn job, which he does. But in his honor, I will give a shout out to the Memphis baseball team that beat Ole Miss yesterday 9-4. Good for you, Memphis baseball. I believe they lost to Ole Miss last month. I believe they lost to a very bad Lipscomb team last month as well. But last night, an SEC victory for Memphis baseball. 9-4. Go Tigers, go. It's always good when Memphis beats Ole Miss in something, anything. Happy, Jacob?
No, you're making him work. He's not.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I forgot. He sent us all the showboat stuff earlier this week, and I totally... Whew. We're going to have the Showboats quarterback on the show on Friday. Memphis Showboats quarterback Case Cookus is going to join us ahead of the Showboats home opener, which is this Saturday in Memphis. Now you can do your thing.
Draymond Green highlights playing tight end for Michigan State spring game. Now, Draymond is an odd size for NBA. Perfect size for a tight end. Draymond's skill set being that height, that size, is at, on the wing, but it's like, we don't think Draymond can play on the wing. They tried it. He couldn't, but he is tenacious as a power forward, so it all works. But the thought was, oh, he's too small to be a big, but he'd be perfect as a tight end. Let's watch Draymond Green highlights. Get him highlighted right there over there on the left. False start. What are you doing, Draymond? Got to wait till the ball goes. Got to wait till the ball gets snapped, Dre. But look at him get off the...
What like, number is it? 83?
Come on, 83.
Let's go, 83.
Come on, 83. Gotta wait. Gotta wait a little bit. He looks good. He fills that uniform out nicely.
He's so
there
excited.
There he is on the outside. Getting jammed into oblivion. My goodness.
So close.
Can't get those hands off of him. His stance is kind of awkward as well. Come on, Draymond. Got to be a bit better than
Why
that.
Why don't more people seek these highlights out? I feel like Grizzlies fans would love watching Draymond Green fail at football.
Because... my hatred for Draymond is strong.
Sure.
Because of the Michigan State thing. The professional sports hate and college sports hate are two different levels of hate.
You go back to National Player of the Year, Draymond.
Yeah, like that hate is a different type of hate. We Michigan fans have had fun with this clip. We Michigan fans will poke some more fun at Draymond every now and then.
Happy for you.
NBA fans, they're not that concerned about what happened in college. They only care about the nut kicking and stuff in the NBA.
Story time.
Which one?
We're going to start with too much cuddling because it officially won with 30% of the vote. And if we have time afterwards, we might do a second story. All right. My son and his girlfriend cuddling. How much is too much? My 15-year-old and son, his girlfriend. Start over. My 15-year-old son and his girlfriend have been spending a lot of time together. We require the door open always and a decent line of sight. We see you, parents.
Don't let these two in a room together. Like, don't let them in the bedroom together. Keep the three box up, Jacob. I like the way that three box look. You, as a parent, do not let your daughter or son have their significant other in the room, even with the door open alone.
They cuddle on his bed and watch TV. They're just watching TV.
No.
The first day he had a bunch of hickeys. All right, new rule. Next time I see hickeys, this all ends. Haven't seen any since. It started as big spoon, little spoon cuddling. Today I went in and she was sitting with him between her legs, hugging her and laying with his head on her chest. I was like, yo, that's a bit much. For context, we also have a 5-year-old and a 4-year-old. I don't want them seeing inappropriate things. Understandable. I know that teens are sexually active. We have had the talk. He has access to birth control. She has the arm implant. What the hell is the arm implant?
You don't know about the arm implant?
No, I don't know about the arm implant.
They used to bombard us with those arm implant commercials.
What?
They just put it like right up here in your shoulder.
Like a nicotine patch?
Well, it wouldn't be a patch. No, it's an implant. Like they stick it into.
How does that work?
It goes in here. I think
I have literally never heard about an arm implant birth control.
And because it's here, just subcutaneously speaking, excuse me, the hormones it emits gets into your bloodstream, gets seeped into your bloodstream, excuse me, and it does the things that birth control do.
As with every form of birth, I love the safe or not, is the arm birth control safe?
Probably
the implant
not.
Is very safe for most people, but all medications have some risks and side effects. What every woman has heard forever. Okay, back to the arm implant. She has it.
Are you trying to get the arm implant?
No, that sounds horrible.
All right.
I never had an IUD. I'm just old school. Still an oral contraceptive. That's what we go with. Okay, so I guess I'm asking, how much cuddling is too much cuddling? Should I be making them sit 3 feet apart? I was a teen once. Hell, his father and I are high school sweethearts going 17 years strong. My husband wants them to never touch, but I think that is, IDK, a bit hard ass. I may be in the wrong here. Your thoughts?
First off, come out that damn bedroom. You know, one. Two, how close should they be? Put them on a couch. Say, hey, y'all sit on the couch for me real quick. And then you take your ass over there and sit in between,
right between
them. And that's how far they need to be. You look left, you look right. You be like, hey, this is how far y'all need to be on this couch. And however, you're probably not super wide. So however wide you are, they'll still be able to hold hands. They'll be able to like play fight a little bit.
Right.
But that's how far y'all need to be away from each other in this house. What the hell are we talking about? Kids have, some of you guys don't know how privileged you are that you didn't have to sneak around in cars and get things popping. To leave a hickey, to put hickey work in, man, have to be in a Mustang to make that stuff shake. Couldn't be in my bedroom or her bedroom. That shit wasn't flying. No, No, you're not overreacting. You want to be a grandmama? You want to be granddaddy? No? All right, separate them two horn dogs.
I actually agree with you. Make them work for it. Now, I don't think the whole, like, save room for Jesus in the middle of the couch is always the right answer. But, like, a movie night, if you will. If there's a group of kids around and, like, the couple is cuddling on the couch or couples are cuddling on the couch. I don't know. I'm not a parent yet. This is where things get really complicated for me thinking as a future of a parent because it just makes me...
Cuddling? Cuddling on the couch with a group of kids who are also all horned up?
You want to know the most audacious thing I ever did?
Yes.
Never mind. It's a story for off the show.
Blankets, I'm just
Sorry.
Saying this.
I hate when I do that, but I changed my mind in the middle of it.
Blankets and jackets, things have popped off underneath both.
That's growing up. Learning the lay of the land.
Absolutely. The lay of the land. I see that.
The lay of the land. I guess Miss Kim said in the chat, separate them at the house. They'll just do it in the car. Yes, but make them do it in the car. That's the point. Make them go to a movie. Make them. Nobody's making out at movies anymore, CJ. Nobody is making out in movie theaters. One, because the movie theaters have made it impossible to do so. Those armrests are so big. Camera schmamp. That's what movie theaters are for. What are you? I mean, not anymore, though. Not anymore.
Because you can't move the armrests.
You can't move the armrests. You are stuck. Unless you want to go... you know, very aggressive place in a movie theater. Like, you have to get on top of the other person at a movie theater to make that work. You just can't do that.
I'm sure I'm a movie theater expert. I've walked in to clean a theater before, and kids have come out behind the screen. So, like, you can go back behind the screen and get stuff popping if you're dedicated enough, if that's what you're into. But no, in the seat, just easily? No, can't do it.
Okay, so then I get into this weird parenting place where, what did Jacob say? I'm not even going
to
ask.
He said he wants to talk to Senior again.
Oh, God.
He wants to talk to Senior. But nobody was in the house when that popped off. Whatever allegedly may have happened. Mm-hmm.
You also don't want to shame your, like, you don't want to have shame around sex. Now I'm getting into, like, Dr. Ruth level. But
there's age-appropriate things. Sure. But you have to get... This is all age-appropriate behavior for leaving hickeys for a 15, 16-year-old, and that's what I'm assuming
totally
the age is. Totally normal. It's not an age-appropriate for the 4- and 5-year-old. Have you ever tried to reason with a 15- or a 16-year-old? Have you ever tried to reason with a horned-up 15- or 16-year-old? That's not something that's going to work.
Stressful.
Hey, listen, you got to dial it down. Brothers, sisters are around. That's not age appropriate for them. I'm fine with you doing it. But when they're in the house, you can't. You don't see your father and I doing this when they're in the house. Do you know how often your father and I get it in? Huh, you wouldn't believe it, right? So, but with them around, you can't do that.
Yeah.
He's not going to listen. You know why? Because the head he's thinking with isn't the head up here. He's thinking with the other head. He's horned up. No. It's not shame. You tell them why. Tell them why it's happening. Hey, we don't want that around the kids.
And have conversations around safe sexual activity. Yeah. Consent.
This is consent. This is safe. If you're doing it, be careful. Don't do it here. Don't bring me no grandchildren.
I saw the craziest TikTok yesterday. You know, I see a lot of crazy. I actually saw three crazy TikToks yesterday. One, did you know that women, your maternal grandmother, like, somehow her eggs are connected to you. So the trauma that your maternal grandmother, I use trauma just because that's like something that can definitively be passed down. There's this study where these people who went through, there was a group of Dutch women who went through a famine, and it showed that it wasn't just their daughters who were affected by the 6-month period that they were in their famine. Their granddaughters were affected, or their grandchildren were affected, where they had higher BMIs and higher levels of obesity because it was like a body's fight or flight response to not having any food for a significant period of time. Anyway, found that out. Then I found out that the government is responsible for stuffed crust pizza because we had an excess of cheese. And the government created this whole extra, like, dairy department where they were convincing all of the pizza restaurants to put as much cheese as possible onto their pizzas, as much cheese as possible into any fast food establishments. But a part of that was the creation of stuffed crust pizza. And I'm like, TLDR. And there's a lot of steps between government creates stuffed crust pizza and excess of cheese. And three, there was a video of, you know, when people go to those like certain political party conventions and then go ask people questions along the way. The question of the day is like, at what age do you think young girls should start learning about consent? If I tell you, a woman said 30. 30. She said, I don't know. 30.
30.
30.
30.
Can you imagine not knowing what consent 30. Is until you're 30 years? And I don't even mean consent from like a sexual way. Like, what if I just went up and like high-fived you until you gave me a high-five back? I was like, why won't CJ give me a high-five? Like, if you don't want to give me a high-five, that's consent. 30. Yes or no? 30.
Wow.
30.
Wow. On the grandmother things.
Sure. I know that was a lot.
That has to be a percentage, right? Because you're not the... There's a chance you end up with your grandmother's X chromosome. Mm. But there's another chance you end up with your grandfather's X chromosome. Because that's how your mom is made. Your mom is two X chromosomes, one from your grandmother, one from your grandfather. She gives you one. Your father gives you the other one. So there's a 50% chance that one of those X's is from your grandmother. So that's got to be a percentage. Either way it goes,
interesting.
That is incredible to think about how past experiences can then be passed down to offspring. But it kind of makes sense because this is how mutations end up happening.
Exactly.
There's a change in the environment. Somebody has in that environment has to adapt, and that adaptation needs to be passed down to the offspring to make sure that the offspring can now exist in this new environment. 30?
30.
Wow.
And then that was a woman's response.
Wow.
And then a dude's response 30. Was, well, maybe there's like one last class you take in high school before you go to college. One last course your senior year where like the last chapter
high school
is briefly touching on consent, but that teachers should have no say in
high school.
It was like, I was like, oh my God, we're
1 year old. The second you're old enough to understand like, oh, this is where this stuff comes from. The second you can understand that, like, hey, we need to have a talk about your penis and or your vagina. Come on,
let me share with you. Oh, God, I hate when you say the words out loud.
Let me share with you what's going on down here. And by share with you, you're one. I'm not going to give you all of it, right? But it is, hey, that's yours. Nobody gets to touch that without your permission. That's all consent is. This here, all of this here belongs to me. All of that over there belongs to you. I can't touch you without your permission. You can't touch me without my permission. It's that bleeping simple. Why are people so damn stupid? 30? In high school? Get out of here. And your kid get molested and be like, oh, why didn't you tell anybody? Because they didn't have the words. You never taught them that that was wrong, what was happening.
That was a very effective summary of consent. So we can now go on to the next story time.
Story.
Speaking of consent.
Oh, there's a drone flying around outside. I think Courtney's out there getting shots of the stadium. But next story.
That's exciting. Next story. Am I the a-hole for asking another mom to keep pictures she took of... Oh, God, we went out into the rehoming of the dog story. Hold on. Am I the a-hole for asking another mom to keep pictures she took of our kids playing private? Sanity check, please. I was with my three-year-old at the park today, and he met and started playing with another boy there. The other kid's mom expressed how cute it was that they were playing together and immediately pulled her phone out and started taking pictures and videos of them. I will admit, I probably spend far too much time on social media reading horrible things about child exploitation in the internet. I'm very careful not to have any pictures of him on social media just because I'm a private person in general. I'm a people pleaser, so it was really awkward for me to say anything. But I felt a bit uncomfortable, so eventually mustered up the courage. I very politely mentioned that I don't put any pictures of him online, so if it was okay to not post it on social media. I genuinely did say it like that, and it wasn't confrontational at all. Well, this mom got very offended and angry at me. She told me, of course, I wouldn't put it on social media, and was visibly very annoyed. She then spoke to her son in their native language, and he promptly turned to my son and said, no. Made go-away gestures and stopped playing with him. This was upsetting for my son. I feel pretty awful and think maybe I overreacted, but you just don't know with how comfortably everyone seems to put strangers on social media. I feel sad I interrupted my son's playtime and anxious at whether I did the wrong thing. I really think I would have asked before taking a picture of somebody else's kid. I have never done it. Thoughts? You are not the a-hole.
No.
We are out of control
as
a society, as a humankind, of taking so many pictures of children and putting them on social media over and over and over again. We do not You can love your kid. You can love everything. You can take pictures of your kid. You can have scrapbooks of your child. You can keep all these pictures for them. And someday, if they want to throw a TBT back to the time when they were playing in the sandbox with a bucket over their head and big sunglasses, I don't know, I'm speaking from experience, then yes, they can post it someday. But I do not need an entire feed of your kids and your kids' friends and everybody involved in them and their entire kindergarten class. And they don't need it either. I do think it is a very weird thing, this experience of like people being born and having no say whatsoever if they have a profile on the internet. People make pages for their children. That's so bizarre to me. I'm not a parent, admittedly. I would like to not, I would strive. There's, and I'm not saying never. Like, I love a good baby after the birth, like congratulations, if you want to, and if you don't, that's cool too. I love an occasional like first day of kindergarten, but I do not need every single time your baby picks up a crayon and draws the Mona Lisa or whatever their version of it is on the timeline.
That's the issue.
Don't need it.
That's the issue. It's not the Mona Lisa. I wouldn't need to see the Mona Lisa because that's a garbage ass painting.
It's true, but, so small.
But like, your kid is just drawing squiggly lines. I don't need to see that all of the time. To quote that great American, I'm tired of seeing your ugly ass kids on my feed. Mm. Shout out to other Jacob with that quote. I am tired of it also. That's me selfishly though. But for you as the parent, and you're not the a-hole. You did the right thing. You don't want your kid up there. I understand why. The other mom reacting the way that she did. How big of a jerk do you have to be to see two kids playing and to get upset because somebody say, hey, don't post a picture of my kid. Yes. To then say, hey, child, you can't play with him anymore.
Child.
Like, come on now. That's weak. That's stupid. And she was absolutely going to post that picture unedited
and
online.
It's so weird. As Steven put in the chat, like, it's so true. The only reason you could possibly post a photo of someone else's child with your own child is for likes. Like, why else are you doing it? You can create shared albums. I have an iPhone, so I'm not gonna speak for all phones, but I assume there is a way, or through Google Photos or whatever your photo sharing service, like if it's a matter of showing your family and your friends, take a poll, take a query, who wants constant pictures of my kid? Because God bless, I'll take them. My whole album can be pictures of the kid. You just don't have to post them. And you can still share them with your friends and family, because I do think that's a beautiful thing about the internet. Like if grandparents don't live close or aunts and uncles don't live close, you have the opportunity to allow that child to grow up in front of their eyes too, thanks to pictures and technology. That's wonderful. You don't have to put it all over social media. And I see some people sitting in like the balance, and again, you make your own choices. We'll judge you a little bit, but like at the end of the day, you make your own choices. I've seen some people who like post their kid, but post it with like emojis over their face. To me, like that's still posting. Like your kid is still there. I see their body. Not in a creepy way, just in a, like, that's a baby. Guess what? I know what your kid's face looks like. I can fill in the blanks, and I'm sure some other people can too. So instead of just like trying to jump through all these hoops, why don't you just not? It took me 3 scrolls on Instagram to find a baby. 3. And guess what? It was adorable.
Thanks for rubbing it in.
It was so cute. Adorable. All right, let's do a couple WTF stories before we get into the rest of our Wednesday. I saw this in the New York Times, and it made me legitimately say WTF. Do you know how many kids aren't going to school anymore, CJ?
How many?
A lot. This graphic from the New York Times polling kids who returned to school after 2020 and the pandemic, and showing that 26% of U.S. students are chronically absent from school. And I actually just had this conversation with a woman here in Memphis whose job is to try to get kids to enroll in schools, because half the battle is just getting them enrolled to go into a school in the first place. Then the next step, like there's different departments for this. Like there's one department that's all about enrollment. Then there's another department that's all about trying to make sure once those kids are enrolled that they actually get to school. But the drop off showing like in 2021, 2022 is 28%. You would have thought, okay, maybe like 1 year after the pandemic, it makes sense. But then for it to only have dipped down to 26%, yikes.
And
school is optional.
We've devalued public school education. And I'm not talking about the facilities component. I'm not talking about that. That's a different conversation. I'm talking about its place in our minds as a collective. it is not valued at all. And it's this trend doesn't surprise me because we are also seeing an uptick in homeschooling and in private schooling because people think, oh, that's just brainwashing over there. Why do I need to send my child there? They can just stay at home, or I can homeschool them, or they can go to this school or just not go to school and they'll end up fine, right? Like, there's a reason why the stories of people who don't have high school degrees or who don't have college degrees that and they find a way to become successful. There's a reason why those types of stories are told so much. It's because, yo, that's an anomaly. Right. That's amazing. Most people need that. I'd say 85 to 90% of us need that, not just from an educational standpoint, but how to deal with a diverse population. Because we are not one thing over here in these here United States. They say we're a melting pot. So how are you going to know how to interact with people who are different than you if you never do it? You were never asked to do it as a kid. Then you grow up and now you don't know. It blows your mind that people in the world have different opinions than you. And then you start lashing out in really weird ways. So it's not surprising. It's disheartening, but it's not surprising. And I think that's something that we need to figure out because we can't have, what did you say?
26%.
A quarter of the population
who are school age children.
Chronically absent. We can't have that. And then expect us to continue to be, and by us, I mean the U.S., continue to be a successful nation in the years to come.
Chronically absent is defined as missing 10% of a school year. So that's a lot. This woman, and then we'll move to the next subject, but she described it as, like, public schools have never had to sell themselves. It's always been the assumed. Like, step one, you go to public school. But then a private school could sell their side. A charter school could sell their side. Homeschooling can sell their. This is the answer. Public schools have never had to do a PR effort. And now we're at a point where, like, public schools, get on TikTok, sell the kids your value, sell the youth your value, and more importantly, their parents. All right, next up, Lizzo. We didn't get to this earlier in the week, but I'm glad we didn't because now there's been an update. Lizzo quit, and then she unquit, but actually she just clarified on what she was quitting. So let's go to the Instagram post that came out this weekend first. An Instagram post from Lizzo that actually made our group chat, which is a rarity, but she said, "I'm getting tired of putting up with being dragged by everyone in my life on the internet. All I want is to make music and make people happy and help the world be a little bit better than how I found it, but I'm starting to feel like the world doesn't want me in it. I'm constantly up against lies being told about me for clout and views, being the butt of the joke every single time because of how I look, my character being picked apart by people who don't know me and disrespecting my name. I didn't sign up for this shit. I quit." What did you think she meant by this statement, CJ?
I thought she was attention seeking. I didn't think she was going to be done with music. That's why I sent it to the group. I sent it to the group because I know attention seeking behavior. And it's like, okay, what do you want? You want people to see this post and then beg you not to? Apparently, some of y'all must have because she's like, no, I didn't mean that. Let me clarify. Like, she was just in a place where she wanted some damn attention and she got it. And now she's like, okay, let me clarify now.
Here's her clarification. In a swimsuit.
I want to make this video because I just need to clarify. When I say I quit, I mean, I quit giving any negative energy attention. What I'm not going to quit is the joy of my life.
You can cut it off after this. That was the gist of it.
Because I know I'm not alone.
How did you
not know? Can I just say her eyeshadow is popping?
Am
I
like, Lizzo is a pretty woman.
Oh. Beautiful.
Apparently she's a monster to work for, but she's a pretty woman.
Well, that's a piece of this too, because you saw that some are speculating this is happening right now because their motion to toss out the entirety of the sexual harassment lawsuit by her former dancers was denied. So the case is moving forward, even though her lawyer wants you to focus on the fact that like 18 of the things have been squashed, but there's still very much a lawsuit with that story. And
this isn't one. Before I make some sort of a point, how the hell did you not know that she was in a bathing suit? You sent this video.
I only saw the top of it.
Like, I thought she was in her top neck?
I thought it was like cut off here. I didn't see the bottom. I didn't know she was just in a, it might not be a bathing suit. It could be a unitard.
Okay, what's wrong with the bottom? If you're okay with this being shown, you got to be okay with the bottom. Either way it goes. Listen.
I don't care, period. I just wanted to, in Lizzo's words, say, Imagine if you told your bot, like, I quit. And then he was like, okay, here's your resignation paperwork.
And you show up the next day? And you, like, no, I quit with your negativity.
And he has this box on your desk, and it's like, please pack up your things and be gone. She's like, no, I didn't mean, like, I quit. I mean, I quit your negative energy.
Like, come on, man. Come on.
What in the woo-woo girl is that?
How old is Lizzo?
I don't know. But I'm rooting for her. I love her.
This is something she can come back from, right?
Yes.
Like, this isn't something that's going to end a career. This feels like something.
It doesn't end men's careers.
This feels like it's something like, hey, Lizzo, please don't do
Lizzo's
that anymore.
Lizzo's 35.
Okay, so she's one of us. This feels real Gen Z.
One of us.
That's unfortunate.
Oh, I think it feels very millennial.
I think it feels very millennial. We are horrible. We are terrible people.
Let me rephrase. I think it feels very like person currently living in 2024 who seeks validation on the internet.
That's millennial.
And unfortunately,
that's millennial.
Gen Z does it a little bit. Everyone does it a little bit.
Okay.
If you're posting online, what are you posting for? Shits and giggles?
I guess. Yeah. I don't know. I don't want to get into all of that, but basically
that's for our next conversation.
We gave y'all way too much yesterday. Ran out of the edibles. It's just annoying. I hate when people do that.
Yes.
That sort of woe is me. Somebody come comfort me. Kids do this. Children do this. Where they're I'm crying. Are you looking at me? Because I'm crying.
Right.
You better come console me. You better come tell me everything's going to be okay. And you're 30 bleeping five. Stop it. Take this lump, emerge better, learn from this mistake, and go out there and make music. I still rock with Lizzo. Like, let's go.
Yeah, make new music. Let's go. I love your music.
That's all Chris Breida. Let me stop. That's all Chris Breida. I almost said it out loud. That's all Chris Brown did.
Excuse me.
That's all Chris Brown did.
If Chris Brown can come back.
Chris Brown did nothing but, like, make new music. And we're like, oh, okay. The women, like, oh, okay. He beat the hell out of Rihanna, but it's fine.
Right.
He gave us a new music.
We saw the pictures.
We read the police report of him beating and biting that woman. It's like, I know, it's fine. It's fine. And every time he has one
what
of those
was
allegations.
His first song back? Was that,
I know her first song afterwards was S&M. That was her first song afterwards. I'm not sure.
I thought
if
her
first
song
one...
afterwards was the sad one.
Take a Bow?
Yeah.
I thought it was S&M.
You put on quite a show.
She might have dropped two back to back.
Okay.
Was Chris Brown's first song These Women Ain't Loyal? That couldn't have been it. That feels like years after that.
Because I was wondering if it was. Okay, his first video after was I Can Transform You.
No, it was not.
Yes, he can.
Come on.
Yes, he can.
Come on.
He absolutely can.
I can transform you. I can transform you. You sure do. It's not funny.
You made the joke. It's not Women's History Month anymore.
It wasn't a joke. It was
a fact.
You
don't have to be on eggshells around you women.
It's true.
We're done caring about you.
You're not wrong. One thing that I spent way too long trying to look up yesterday to not mention it on the show. 7-Eleven does their like Slurpee, I don't know, extravaganzas. And they have a bunch of events in April. And one of them is, wait, was this fake? I'm going to cry.
Oh, no. You're finding out it's fake in real time?
I kid you not. I spent so long yesterday trying to see if this was fake or real.
What is it?
It's real.
Okay,
what a dumb headline. April Fool's Day may be over for this year, but 7-Eleven Inc. is still in the mood for fun. That's the first sentence. The headline is 7-Eleven trades fooling for fun. I don't know. It's just complicated. It's real. Bring your own cup day. You can bring your own cup to a 7-Eleven on April 13th, and you can fill.
What?
So I am going to take my sweet, sweet water bottle. I'm going to find a 7-Eleven. We do not have any like near us because I've looked. I used to love.
I don't think that we have any here.
No, I'm going to have to go to another state. I'm going to have to find the closest 7-Eleven because when I first moved here, like 7-Eleven Day was a holiday in our household where you went and you got your free Slurpee on 7-Eleven. If for those of you in Memphis who have never had the gift of a 7-Eleven in your life, the Slurpee machine at 7-Eleven is like legendary and you can get a mix of all of them. You can create like a concoction of different 7-Eleven Slurpee flavors. But apparently on April 13th, according to Concession Stand Daily, you can actually bring your own giant big cup.
There's one off Lamar.
Yeah. Is there?
Yeah.
No, it's not. It's not branded as a 7-Eleven.
38114. Right around the corner.
38114?
Yeah, right around the corner.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Not the new one. I can see it also. I cannot. I think it's the Lamar Danny Thomas intersection.
Why does it not come up?
What do you mean? I just Googled 7-Eleven near me, and 7-Eleven.com says 3095 Lamar Avenue. I think that either it's there at that intersection or the two lights up.
According to MapQuest, there's one in on Mill Branch, but I don't think MapQuest has been updated.
When's the last time anybody has ever said MapQuest?
It came up in the search. What? It's the thing.
That's your issue?
Does Memphis have 7-Eleven?
That's your issue?
MapQuest says there is one, but I don't believe that because I would never go, like, trust your sources here, people. MapQuest is not a thing.
MapQuest wearing red hats? Like, why are we taking shots at MapQuest?
I just need somebody to tell me if there's really a 7-Eleven.
Let's drive down Lamar and find a 7-Eleven.
We have to end the show. I have to go find out if there's a 7-Eleven. And importantly, if there's a working Slurpee machine, because that's the next step. You go find a 7-Eleven, and then they tell you that the Slurpee machine isn't working. Sometimes it's worse than McDonald's. Hope everyone has a wonderful rest of your Wednesday. Thanks for hanging with us on this beautiful midway point of the week. We'll be back tomorrow. CJ won't. CJ's off tomorrow. Congratulations to him. Bennett Doyle will be with me in the studio. We'll draft something. I don't know what. We'll have a good day. Grizzlies, Bucks tonight. You only have two more road games for the Grizzlies this season, so buckle up. That game tips off at 7 o'clock. We'll be back tomorrow to talk about it. We'll see you then. Bye.
When is 7-Eleven Day? Is it today?
Well, 7-Eleven Day is 7-Eleven, okay, July 11th. But the giant Bring Your Own Cup Day is April 13th. BYOC. Bye, y'all. Okay. Bring your own cup.
We need to go to a 7-Eleven before the show with the most ridiculous cups. Other Jacob
two
says.
Two hosts, one cup.